That's a nice one, yeah. We tend in the mindfulness classes, we use a raisin quite often, and we eat that very slowly. A very tiny thing to taste. But really, I think eating is an important one, because it's so, these days, so many people are eating, and, you know, we all do it sometimes. We eat and we just don't taste what we're eating. We. Yeah, so we get to the end of our sandwich and we haven't even tasted a bite of it. So this is something we can really work with, even just taking, you know, 10 or 15 minutes at lunchtime to actually stop and eat properly, and or to have a cup of tea and to really taste the tea instead of just doing the next thing. So I think that's another good area at the moment. And I'm sure that there are some people who might think that this is a fad and that this is, you know, this year's flavor and this will go away. But I think mindfulness really is here to stay, because I think that mindfulness is an approach that's really helping us with a lot of the things that we can kind of feel in our bones are going wrong in our society and our lifestyle. You know, a sense of feeling very fragmented, our technology is pulling us in many directions, a sense of the pace is constantly revving up further and further, and we really feel it in a city like London, such a big place where it takes us so long just to get from A to B, and we're constantly feeling rushed and pressurized. So I think that it's a challenge to think about how we can be mindful in an environment that feels often not very mindful, and that's the challenge that I kind of set myself in this book. And it's a challenge I've been thinking about for a long time, because I moved to London about 25 years ago, and when I first came, it was such a jolt to my system. I'd been living in small university towns. I'd actually been writing a PhD in history, so my life was very slow. It involved a lot of sitting in the library and, you know, cycling around on an old bicycle. And then I came to London and I took a job with the BBC as a radio producer, which is a very frenetic kind of job. You know, you have to get interviewees onto the live radio and off again, and the deadlines are completely non-negotiable, so there's a lot of pressure there. I found it very exciting, but I really noticed I was feeling very stressed and my whole body was reacting to that. And luckily I found meditation, as we called it then, when there wasn't such a thing as the secular mindfulness movement in those days. So I found a Buddhist center and learned how to meditate, and found that that was something that really gave me a sense of groundedness, a sense of stability, a sense of some kind of core that I could come back to, that helped me to deal with the sort of craziness of London and of my working life. So when I left the BBC a few years ago, I decided to train as a mindfulness teacher. So this was at the moment when secular mindfulness, that is, meditation techniques being used in a way that's completely without any belief system that you have to sign up to. They're just used as a natural human skill. And that was just taking off in the UK. So I trained as a mindfulness teacher about 6 years ago and began to teach mindfulness classes and also to write about mindfulness. And so when I had the opportunity, when I got this book commissioned called Mindful London, it was really a good chance to think about, okay, well, how can we bring this approach into the chaos of the city? And we might think it's a contradiction in terms. You know, we might think of mindfulness as being all about sort of stillness and spaciousness, and the city being all about kind of, you know, energy and freneticism and so on. So I think when my publisher first, you know, was working with me with the idea of Mindful London, the publisher really had in mind probably a guide to places that are quiet, that are restful, you know, where we can take time out, where we can nourish ourselves. And that is certainly part of what the book is about. So I think the way I see it is, yes, it's about time out, and it's also about time in. It's also about how can we bring what we get from that nourishment and that sort of those ways that we take space for ourselves, that we have time for being rather than doing. How can we bring those that quality into the chaos and the bits of the city that we find most irritating and frustrating, and the bits of our daily life that we find most irritating and frustrating? So I'm really working on those two angles, you know, sort of how do we take the time out, how do we bring that into our lives. So in terms of the time out, I think we're very lucky in this city. We have fantastic resources. It's such an exciting, rich city that has so much to offer us in the way of what we might call leisure time. But sometimes our leisure time isn't very leisured. You know, sometimes we can actually approach our leisure time as frenetically as we approach our working life, for example. Art galleries, you know, many of us go and see an art exhibition when it's the big blockbuster exhibition that's here and we've paid our money to see that. And we go rushing around and we have to see absolutely every painting, and maybe we spend 30 seconds with each piece of artwork. That's what the researchers have shown, that most people spend 30 seconds with a piece of art. So I'm really interested here, how can we bring a mindful approach to art, for example? And we're so lucky here that we have free art galleries. You know, many of us might be passing, for example, you know, the National Gallery or Tate Modern or Tate Britain, and we could just pop in for 15 minutes, 20 minutes, and spend that time with one piece of art or two pieces of art. And I actually did that with a group of friends. We've done this a few times where we went to a gallery and we split up and we took an hour. And we said, okay, in that hour you could only see maybe two or three paintings maximum, or artworks, and sort of really spend a lot of time with each one and not spend the whole time reading the caption, but actually just stand there and absorb it. So I've worked, you know, played with that a little bit in the book. How can we bring that approach to art? Nature. We have a fantastic, you know, we were very lucky that in this city the Victorians, and actually you're even going back to the sort of the early 18th century, people thought about creating green spaces right in the middle of the city. So we have over 400 garden squares in London that have been preserved. And so almost anywhere that we are, we can go in just for a few minutes and, you know, spend time with trees, or we have so many commons and heaths and so on. And I really love, there's a project by the Woodland Trust, which is called the Ancient Tree Hunt, and it encourages you to go and find the most ancient trees, and if you like, you can, you know, add to their map of ancient trees, or you can just go and look for them, or look up on the web where they are. And usually the way you can tell they're ancient is because they're big. And the way that you measure them actually is by a hug. So this gives a great excuse for hugging trees. So 1.5 meters is an adult hug, apparently. So if it's sort of 3 or 4 hugs, a tree is definitely a tree that's probably 300 or 400 years old. So we have some amazing trees. And then even just, you know, walking along our streets, we have actually more trees than there are Londoners, which is pretty amazing. So I think taking the time to appreciate those things, and also architecture. So much of the time we're just walking along on a kind of autopilot, where we're just aware of, you know, the street level and the signs, and if we just take the time to look up, we see there's some incredible, interesting details, gargoyles, and you know, interesting windows and masonry and so on. So this is really about bringing a mindful approach into the resources of the city, and then I suppose that, I mean, there are other ways we can think of it. So in terms of music, for example, you know, how can we listen to music in a way that's really focusing on the music, that we're actually listening to it as opposed to just having it as background? How can we use restful spaces like churches? You know, we have incredible churches that are often empty and that you can just go in and spend a little bit of time in there as a place to be still. So I think that's part of what I've been trying to explore and sort of encouraging other people to explore. But then also, how can we bring this mindfulness? Just to say, you know, mindfulness, what does it mean? It's really mainly about being present. So it's about training the mind to keep coming back to the present. And so how can we be present even with the difficult bits? And this, I think, is the most challenging part. So I've got a chapter in my book about mindful commuting and traveling. And how can we actually sort of, for example, survive the tube at rush hour? And looking at ways that we can ground ourselves in that situation, that we can maybe take a breathing space. We can, you know, actually pay attention to our breath for a few minutes when between one tube stop and another. If we're sitting, we can feel the bottom on the seat and really be grounded. If we're standing, we can hold on to the pole and, you know, ground ourselves as much as we can with all the jostling. I think also we can take opportunities, you know, when we feel thwarted by things like queues, you know, the famous British queue. And we can spend the whole time in a queue feeling completely irritated and frustrated and getting more and more wound up. Or we can take that queue as a sort of moment where, okay, we're stuck here. You know, we're given at this moment an opportunity that we don't have to do anything. There's nothing we can do. We don't have to look at our phone. We don't have to, you know, create something extra to do. How can we use that moment in a queue as a moment of a pause? So creating little pauses, allowing ourselves little pauses in the whole sort of turmoil of city life. Another one that I really like is thinking about the pedestrian lights, and we always think that the green man is wonderful and the red man we hate because he stops us. But how could we actually sort of make friends with the red man and think again, okay, I'm stuck here for a few minutes, you know, I can't cross. Can I just take the red man as a gift that's saying, okay, pause, let's feel the ground, let's sort of look around maybe, you know, look up and around and appreciate the city. And I think also we can use sounds, for example, sirens, and there's a lot of noise in the city that can be something that kind of revs us up and makes us feel constantly irritated. Or we can we find a way to sort of flip that and find that, for example, if we're walking along and suddenly there's the sound of a siren that cuts through, that's an opportunity where it's actually cutting through our whatever, you know, boring kind of whirlwind of thoughts we were in, and actually giving us a moment to go, oh, here I am, you know, let's be present, let's kind of look around, and let's have a sort of fresh relationship to what's here. So I think I'd be interested if people would be willing to do I talk a lot about breathing space, as I've just been doing, that we can take a breathing space. So maybe I feel that it's only right that when we're talking about mindfulness that we should actually do a little bit of mindfulness. So if you don't want to do this, you can just take this as an opportunity to do nothing, which is almost what we're doing anyway. But if you're happy to do that, I think we'll just take a short breathing space. And so what I would suggest is that we just start by having a sense of the body and the posture. So you can do this either sitting or standing, but as you're sitting right now, having a sense of your feet on the floor, really feeling the sense of the shoes, the contact with the floor, the sense of groundedness. Can you feel all of your toes? Can you feel the soles of your feet? And can you feel the sense of the bottom on the chair? So often when we get very busy, there's a sense that our whole attention is up in the head, the busyness of thoughts, and we can really bring awareness to this grounded quality of the body. And then just giving yourself a moment now to notice how you're feeling. So just seeing whether the body feels tired or energized. Is there adrenaline here? Is there a buzzy quality? Or is it fairly still? Are there aches and pains? Is there tension? Also how you're feeling kind of emotionally and in your mind. Maybe you're feeling irritated or awkward, or your mind is very busy. It's thinking about something else. Just seeing if you can notice how that is, how you're feeling in your body, your emotions, your thoughts. And with a sense that you don't have to change that. So you're just giving it a moment's space to feel what's feeling, that movement of the breath somewhere in the body. And allowing the breath to breathe itself, so you don't have to change it. And if the mind goes somewhere else, that's absolutely natural. You just see if when you notice that the mind's gone somewhere else, you gently bring it back to the breath. I'm just doing that as often as you need to. We're not expecting to have a blank mind. So really simple. We took a few minutes over that, but that's something that you could do in quite a short space, where you just feel a sense of the body and the posture, a good posture. You just notice how you're feeling. Spend a bit of time with the breath, and somehow this is giving us a chance to press the pause button and reset, so that we can then sort of nourish ourselves in these little ways, and then carry on with our day. So I think these are really valuable, and at the same time, if you're really interested in mindfulness as an approach, it's really helpful to also take time for longer practice. So I've got some longer practices in the book, but also some a chapter about mindfulness where you can find courses and centres in London, and books and apps and all sorts of ways of training in mindfulness. So I would encourage you that if you find this an interesting idea, that it's also good to learn how to do the longer practices and to spend some time with those. Is whew, you know, because if we just keep revving up, it does start to take its toll, doesn't it, on the system? If we never listen to that, you know, yeah. So that's interesting. That was what you felt, was whew, I'm exhausted. Yeah. Other people.
That reminds me of.
But actually, that's the art of napping is something we've kind of lost a bit, and it seems to be coming back. Yeah, there are some companies that have that's right, and Huffington Post, for example, there they have actually nap rooms, and they encourage you to take a nap. Appreciation back into the eating. Yeah. In fact, there's a whole slow food movement which started in Italy as a reaction to the fast food, in fact, to a McDonald's that was appearing in a piazza that they weren't happy with, and now there's a whole slow food movement and taking smoking breaks without smoking. So the idea that, you know, smoking was the only excuse you had to go outside and sort of breathe deeply and so on. So how can we actually just go outside and breathe deeply without having a smoke?
So that's a crazy thing.
So I do have a little bit on mindful driving. Yeah. So I think that's obviously a slightly tricky one, because it's not about sort of closing our eyes and going somewhere else, obviously. But I think mindfulness can be very helpful. I mean, one thing we can do is just sort of, when we first get in the car, you know, take a moment before we just rush to kind of, you know, feel that we're sitting in a car and we've kind of, you know, got the hands on the wheels and sort of center ourselves, because it is an environment where we can get very head up, can't we, you know? So I think doing that and seeing if we can, you know, notice when we do have a lot of, you know, anger and frustration coming up, that we can, part of what mindfulness does is actually trains us to be able to work with those kind of things, that we don't get triggered with, that we don't let those trigger us into reactions like, you know, shouting at the other drivers or cutting people off and so on. So welcome the cues, a good one, exactly. And we're also working, I guess, awareness. You know, one of the things that we're working with is being aware of our environment rather than just going into our own thoughts. So of course that's very helpful for driving, that we don't want to be caught up in other things, that, you know, part of what we need is a sort of panoramic awareness, that we're kind of picking up, you know, cues before dangers happen. So I think that training of the mind that allows us to be more present and not to get caught up is very, very helpful for driving. Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, thank you.
I think that's
a really good question, and I think it's kind of both. But I think first of all, what we're not doing in mindfulness is sort of blocking out our experience. So if we feel irritated, you know, we feel irritated. And I think, though, my own experience is that by noticing the irritation and properly, it kind of actually doesn't, it then doesn't trigger us into that kind of negative thinking and reaction, right? That actually we can just let ourselves feel, for example, a very loud noise, you know, that automatically, without us, we have no choice, our whole body is going to do this, right? But if we're aware, we can feel the body do that, we can notice it, whoa, and then actually that enables us then to, you know, let it go, okay, you know, it's just a sound, now I can, you know, and then perhaps we can take that moment where it cut through what else was, you know, that maybe we were stuck in our own mental chatter, and at that moment then we can go, okay, suddenly I notice that I'm walking down a street and I'm not in the office 5 hours ago having an argument with my boss or whatever it is. Does that sort of make sense? I think it's kind of both, but yes, feeling it first is crucial. Yeah, great question. Thank you. More quickly than I would have liked to deliver. I think they were nervous that mindfulness might go out of fashion. So it took me a year between having it commissioned and between it actually coming out, which felt quite short, but I tried to clear as much space as I could to write and really kind of try and live it while I was doing it. So I was really spending a lot of time you know, trying out the exercises and you know, going around sort of asking myself constantly, okay, what does it mean to be mindful in this city? So I found it a really helpful process for myself because, you know, and I don't claim to have all the answers about how we can be mindful in London and so on, but I think that's sort of a starting point for then, you know, perhaps people rediscovering some places that they already love that you've maybe forgotten about, or, you know, looking out around your own neighbourhood for whether there were hidden gems and, you know, those things. It's amazing. I find in my own street in Balham, there are still, I've lived there for 20 years, and, you know, I can still walk down the street and see some little detail in a house that I haven't noticed before, you know. So our environment is so rich, and it's how can we kind of wake ourselves up, you know, to that richness and really enjoy it, because most of us living in a city like London have a sort of love-hate relationship with the city. You know, we sort of adore it, but we also, you know, it triggers us in so many ways. So I think it's how can we nurture the love bit a little bit more. Yeah.
But, you know, there are these
on that one, you know, tube journey, and forget all the other, the beautiful architecture and the parks. And the I know, and when it doesn't work, then we realise how
right.
how you know, really can appreciate it, that it whisks us from A to B so quickly. So yeah, I absolutely agree. I mean, there's a saying that that we are like Teflon for good experiences and like Velcro for bad experiences. So we can kind of start to cultivate that appreciation a bit more, I think, definitely. You know, transform the spaces to be more mindful, yeah. And I think that's absolutely right. And, you know, I think there is some work around sort of mindful design, or slow design is another word that people use, but sort of, you know, architects designing spaces, yeah. Yeah, music in... Yeah, arts in public spaces and that kind of thing, so, yeah. was a group of us that were working with different organisations on that. We found it very hard to get funding. No, we didn't. That's exactly. I mean, it's a bit like the same sort of thing as your siren or whatever, that we notice that. We notice how we're doing that, you know?
Yeah.
And then actually by when we notice it, we might think, oh, maybe I could just, you know, relax with this a little bit. Okay, yes, I'm very crowded, but, you know, I can feel my feet. I can, you know, maybe get hold of something that keeps it, you know, and kind of work with that energy. So again, I think, again, it's feeling what's going on, you know. A lot of people meditate on the tube. I mean, you know, it's hard, you know, standing up, I agree, in rush hour like that. But, you know, when you've got a seat, for example, if you look around, lots of people meditating. You can tell, you know, just something about the slightly more deliberate kind of maybe way they're holding their hands. Or and it doesn't look much different from, you know, just sitting, falling asleep or listening to something on your headphones or whatever. So nobody thinks it's too weird. So we've already had a chorus of yeses. So we've got living proof here, and I'm one as well. So yeah, there's a few of us that meditate on the tube, and I certainly hear when I teach mindfulness classes, which I have people coming every week from all walks of life, and I hear week in, week out, people saying, I did a breathing space on the tube. It really helped, especially people who are really panicky. You know, people who get panic attacks on the tube. Often come back and say, right, I did a breathing space and it worked, and I wasn't panicky anymore. So it's interesting. Yeah.
I used to meditate on the tube.